Good morning, everybody. Hopefully you had a wonderful weekend, and those of you that are down in the southeast, hopefully you are able to recover sooner rather than later. So we're all thinking about you. So we get started here with 5 Minute Moneymaker. Just read an excellent article that addressed the 9 things salespeople do that make them look desperate. Number one is assume people are interested in what you're saying. Now, do we ever assume people are interested in what we're saying? No. In fact, anytime somebody comes into my office, do I believe that they're looking for a second opinion? Do I believe they're looking for help? No, I do not. I believe they're there to get a pat on the back for how well they did. Because guys, the people we want to get in front of, do they have money? Absolutely, they have money. So they're not looking for help. If they wanted help, they would have looked for a long time ago. They're in there to see if maybe an idea or two that they can take back to their guy. But they're mostly in there to have somebody say, yeah, you're doing a good job. And that's what we do with 5Q, isn't it? Now, second, presenting, pressing for a meeting too hard. That's why at the end of the meeting, we ask them how they want to proceed. Jumping on problems too quickly. At the first meeting, if they start pointing out all the problems that they have, I don't like this VA, my guy never talked to me. Do we ever leap on that or do we ignore it? Do we just skate right by it? That's right, Nick. That's right, David. So, we do not jump on. We just skate right by because the first meeting is not about anything except gathering data. Oh, and by the way, the new agreement meeting, I've had person after person after person after person tell me the new agreement meeting is working awesome for them. The whole new part at the beginning about how you're paid, and more specifically those 6 goals scripts, are people are saying 5, 5, 5, 5, 5 all the way down and are excited about going to the next meeting. So if you haven't taken the time to go learn that agreement meeting, do it this week because it's working fantastic. Okay, back into number 4, side agreements. We don't want any side agreements. That's why we follow our system. When somebody wants us to give them things without prerequisite commitment, we do not bend. We do not give them any of the things in the 21-point checklist until they become a client. Issuing ultimatums, we don't do that. Letting your voice communicate nerves. Again, what do we do when somebody, when we get nervous or when we think the meeting is going wrong, what do we do with our voice? What do we do with our voice? Slow down, right? And then what else do we do? Go low and slow. We slow it down and we lower the volume of our voice. Okay? So being too accommodating, we don't do that. I mean, again, we're here to help, but they need to become a client or commitment before we actually help them. Refusing to take a hint. An example of this with 5Q is that if you see the client getting irritated, what do we do at that point? We see a client getting irritated. Do we try to hurry up to the next part? Or what do? We stop, we slow down, we talk low, and we apologize. That's right. And then offering unsolicited opinions. Do we offer unsolicited opinions or do we always ask, you know, for example, when we get into the financial things, what do we say? Do you like things sugarcoated or you want things straight? That's an example of making sure they're not, that they will actually want us to come bring things up to them without just shoving down them. See, what a lot of advisors do is what? They think, they're in my office. They're in my office. Of course they want second opinions. They wouldn't be here if they didn't want second opinions. Guess what, though? They don't want second opinions. They want to be told they're doing things right. So before we actually go in and have them understand how much their advisor is taking advantage of them, how much advisor is disrespecting them, we always, when we get into the money stuff, we say what? Do you like things sugar-coated or do you like them straight? That way they know, oh my gosh, they're prepped. They know I'm about to get bad news. That will save you a lot of problems. So are we doing, do we prevent, with the 5Q system, do we prevent any of these things that make you look desperate? Because the 5Q system is designed to make sure you do not look desperate. So one person, Davis, says, yes, we do that. How about any of the other you? Yeah, we look professional, exactly. Is anybody on the call today, man? You're all on the call, but you all must be sleeping. Okay, now we're getting some people saying yes. Good. So 5Q tape breakdown was about diversification. If you want to hear somebody doing a diversification script with a client, go there. One of the things that that we do not want to come up but does come up is, hey, can you give me a reference? Hey, can you give me a reference? So how do you handle that? Well, first of all, be proactive, not reactive. Be proactive, not reactive. What I mean by that is first build a list of clients who are willing to speak to other clients about you. So have that list there in case you do need to do this. But the best way to be proactive is what? Best way to be proactive is what? Okay. Learn the 5Q process. If you do the, guess how many times, the last 2 years I made 967, guess how many times people asked me for references? They never did, right, Kevin? Why? Why did they never ask me for references? Because at that point, they were so focused on the fact that their guy was taking advantage of them. Were they looking? Did they want to go to the yellow pages at that point? All they knew is they wanted to get rid of their guy as quickly as possible. That was a done deal. Get rid of my guy as quickly as possible. He's taking advantage of me. So then they wanted to, what are they going to do? They're going to work with the guy who pulled the curtain back on all the things that advisors do? What do they know about me? If I showed them all these things that advisors do, you know, for example, with the financial, where these advisors were charging them more to give them less instead of showing them where they could have gotten more and paid less, what do they know about me? Am I going to try to trick them with that? Will I try to trick them with that? If they do not like their guy, they got two choices. They don't like their guy, they got two choices. Work with me or go to the yellow pages. What are they going to do? And remember, is time an issue for these folks? If you do it right, is time an issue for these folks? Yeah, Atan. All right, Kevin, Nick. Is time an issue for these folks if you do it right? Why? That's right, Kevin. Why is time an issue for these folks? That's right, because they want to move right now. They do not want that current guy to have their money 1 minute longer. So the best thing to do is learn the 5Q process. But even the best laid plans, can we somebody throw us a curveball occasionally and want a reference anyways? Maybe we're not as good as we need to be yet, and they could do that. So how do we handle that? So you need to be ready for this and not be surprised. If you're surprised, guess what's going to happen? They're going to see that you're surprised, and surprise is going to look what? Desperate. We don't want to look desperate. So you should be ready with it. But first of all, don't be a pushover. So anytime somebody asks for a reference, I want everybody to answer this. When somebody asks for a reference, is that something we would like to hear or not like to hear? Okay, we don't want to hear. So everybody answer this question then. Anytime we hear something we don't like, what do we do? What's the first thing we do? Anytime somebody says something we don't like, what's the first thing that we do? What's the process that we go through with them? And a lot of right answers here. Agree and gots, right? Agree and gots, agree and gots, agree and gots. Yep. We're going to tell them why asking for a reference is a great idea. You know, absolutely. I mean, anytime you want to move forward, it's great to know the how other people have done, how other people have been treated, you know, the results other people have had. So why not have a reference? Because at this point, if you leave one place, you don't want to just jump from the fire to the firing pan to the fire. You want to make sure it's a good decision. And the best decisions come from people who've actually utilized the services, actually had that experience, can give you good feedback, boots on the ground. So absolutely, when you ask for a reference, that makes total sense. I mean, that's what I do. I mean, that's what I do. I always go and look for a reference. I look for references, at Amazon, I'm looking for how they're rated. I mean, with dentists, I ask people who their dentist is. So when you say get a reference, it makes total sense. So all I'm going to do is what? Agree in gots, right? And then what am I going to do? I'm going to say, so here's no problem. Ask for references. You can call blank, 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 and ask for Mary. That's my mom. That's her cell phone number. Now, why do I do that, guys? They're not going to call my mom. Why am I doing that? What's that telling them? So, Jeff, what do you think that's telling them when I say, here's my mom's phone number? Doing a couple things. First of all, is it going to make them laugh a little bit? Yes. It breaks the and anytime you get them laughing, right, Fred, it's going to get them laugh. So anytime you get them laughing a little bit, it makes it lowers the stress of the whole situation. So I've already lowered it with the gots. Then I give them a little joke. And Jeff, why would you think that I would make the point about, hey, call my mom? And Till already gave me the answer, but
right, it's just making it obvious that you're only going to give them people who are going to say good things about you.
Yes, and did he do that in a sneering way or kind of in a funny way?
Yeah, in a funny way.
In a funny way. So yeah, Till said you're just going to show him that, yeah, you can cherry pick anybody you want. So I'm going to do that and then say, I'm just kidding. I mean, but could I ask you? No. So now we've lowered, I've got them. I've given a little joke that they chuckle at. Now I can ask them a question that would normally be, you know, be a little bit defensive. I don't want to sound defensive. Say, I'm just kidding. I mean, I'm going to give you, we'll get you somebody who can give you a reference. Could I ask what kind of questions you'd be asking so that I can point you to the best reference? Because depending on what you, you know, what you're wondering about, I can point you to one direction or another direction and get you the best reference. Does that seem reasonable or unreasonable at this point? That seems reasonable. And then what I'm going to do when they tell me that thing? I'm going to gots them again. I'm going to gots them again. And then I'm going to do what? Fall on the sword and say, geez, I am so sorry. I should have covered that all those questions up front. That's my fault, blah, blah, blah. What, this whole overcoming this is all what? Lowering their resistance. Then I'm going to ask them open-ended questions to get them to overcome their own objection and why that is silly to even be asking for a reference. And then if you want, you can invite them to a client event if you have one coming up. But again, the best way to handle this, again, is what? What's the best way to handle people wanting references? Be proactive. And what are the two ways you can be proactive? What are the two ways you can be proactive? Learn the system, right? That's the first one. Learn the system. And the second one is what? Have a covey of clients that are willing to give you high endorsements. Does that make sense? Yeah, and Ben asks, hey, what if I don't have my mom? Can I give my wife's number? Yeah, anybody, yeah, and your wife's, your mom's, your brother's, your best friend's, whatever. I mean, all the points are the same, right? So that will work, Ben. Yeah, any of those other ones, if your mom's not available or you don't want to do that. So make sense? So does this make sense as the way that you would cover if they ask for a reference? Best way is learn the system. They're not going to ask for a reference. At that point, they just want to get away from the guy as quickly as possible. But if maybe you were a little bit lazy that day or a little bit tired that day and didn't do a great 21-point checklist, then and that happens, what you got to do is again, quickly, we'll go through that again one more time. We'll agree with it. We'll gots them. Then we'll say, no problem. Here's the number of my mom or my wife or my best friend or whoever may be who you're going to use there. And then you say, I'm just kidding, but could I ask you what kind of questions you'd be asking so I can point you to the best reference? And then you got some again, and then you say, I'm sorry, I should have covered that. Why didn't I cover that? That's my fault. I should have covered those things up front. That's my, you know what? Those are great questions, and that should have been. So you just apologize and tell them that those questions are awesome questions, and then you ask open-ended questions to get them to answer their own, all the things that they were worried about. You ask them open-ended questions to get them to tell themselves that it's not a big problem. And then if you don't have that, if they still want to talk to somebody and you don't have any references to give them, invite them to an upcoming client event. Does that make sense? Is that helpful? Okay, so another thing is I wanted to run by you is that Goldman Sachs bear market risk indicator is at the highest since 1969. So, if we go back to the middle of the 60s, did the market actually crash in the middle 60s and the late 60s? Did it? Yep. Everybody's saying yes, or not everybody, but quite a few people have done their homework and know their history. How about in 73? Did the market crash in 73? Yep. There was and then it didn't crash here. 73 is a big crash. It didn't crash here. But did it crash in 87? Did it crash in 87? Yep. Was there a little crash in 96? Yep. Was there, gosh darn it. Okay. So then it flashed here. It flashed early, didn't it? Because it flashed in 1999. Did the market crash in 1999? No, it crashed when? Yeah, 2001. So it called it, but it called it when? A little bit early. And remember what we talked about like 3 or 4 weeks ago? All the studies that have shown that if you move your money out into an FIA right before the crash, 1 year before the crash, 2 years before the crash, or 3 years before the crash, did it matter? Which one did the FIA beat? If you pulled it out just months before the crash, 1, 2, 3 years before the crash, did it matter? Or did the FIA beat the market over the next 5 years? Yeah, FIA still beat it. So yeah, this did. So would you say this is a great indicator if it called it before, you know, a year or two before the market crash? Then again, in 2008, did it call it? So how accurate is this indicator? Pretty darn accurate, or way, you know, just 50-50? And look at where it's at right now, as high as it's been since that. So what are they using for this indicator? It says Goldman Sachs Group indicator designed to provide a reasonable signal for not you know, prediction. It's just saying this. But how many signals have I shown you over the last 3 months, guys? Just one signal over and over and over, or a multitude of signals? That's right, Sue, lots of them. And they're all saying what? Warning. There are flashing indicator lights all over the place for a market correction. This Goldman's is a bull bear index, which is based on measures of equity value, growth momentum, unemployment, inflation, and the yield curve. Guys, are these all good things to be looking at? I mean, are they just is this a tarot cards they're looking at? Is it astrology they're doing, or are these good things that they're looking at? So while the gauges at this level have historically preceded a bear market, Goldman strategists, including Peter Oppenheimer, wrote in a note last week that a long period of relatively low returns for stocks is more likely than a big crash. That's, of course, if what doesn't happen. So right now, I've told you this analogy before. We're in a room with a bunch of 50-year-old newspapers, gasoline, kerosene, and kindling. Does that mean the room's going to go up in fire? Just because it has newspapers and kindling and kerosene and gasoline doesn't mean it's going to go up fire. No, but it means how many mistakes can be made in that room before the thing goes up. Yeah, one tiny little mistake and that room can go up. So what Goldman is saying here is that, you know, if there's no big triggers here, we're going to see low stock returns. But if there's a trigger, what's going to happen? And guys, in today's environment, how close are we on a daily basis? When you wake up in the morning, the first thing I do every day when I wake up in the morning is I look at the frickin' news, because the news is what? I mean, prior to the last 2 years, I didn't give a crap what was happening with the news. But in the last 2 years, I'm looking at the frickin' news every morning because I don't know what the hell happened in the last 24 hours. So there's lots of things that are out there that could cause this. But even if they say it's low returns, do you think they're talking about 3% and 3% and 3% and 3%? Or do you think they're talking about 10% 1 year, 1% the next year, 12%, 8%, 0%, 9%, -5%, something like that? Variable, right. And what kicks ass in a variable type environment where 1 year it's up and 1 year it's down, or what? FIAs, that's right. That's FIAs. Exactly right. Does that make sense? Okay, so the main topic today we're going to talk about is doing a tape review with 10-year. Now, before you came on to 5Q, how many of you guys leveraged 10-year as a way to get people to realize their guy's screwing them? It's a very innocuous thing. But I'm going to show you how this very tiny little thing can be really leveraged to have them understand my guy is not respecting me. He's taking advantage of me. And again, when it comes to the financial things, what's the little thing I want? What's the little saying I want in your head? Or what's the little logic formula that I want going on in your head with the financial things? Remember, with the non-financial things, I want you to be thinking at the end of every non-financial things, you know, I'm sorry, this is boring stuff. I'm sure you're wondering about what's going on with the money, the fun stuff to talk about. But so I apologize for covering this stuff. I mean, I don't get paid for it. I wonder why I cover it. But what kind of advisor would I be if I didn't cover a power attorney? Medical power of attorney and quality of life directive, the DocuBank, the identity theft, the property casualty. I mean, so with the non-financials, what kind of advice would I be? With the financial, what's the logic formula we're looking at? Right now, you're paying more and getting less for it. Were you shown the thing where you could have gotten more? I'm sorry. You're paying more and getting less for it. Were you shown the thing where you could have gotten more and paid less for it? The total opposite. See, I want to be thinking that with when it comes to fees, when it comes to bonds and safety, and when it comes to tenure. You're paying more for a guy with less tenure when you could have gotten a guy with a lot more experience and paid less for it. Were you shown that? And how many times? See, if I I want you guys to understand this, because I've had this conversation several times with guys, and I think we're missing it, and I'm not doing a very good job of explaining it. So if all what I hear on the tapes, you guys are doing a fantastic, like I've said before, you guys have, so many of you know the 21-point checklist scripts now, so you're doing an awesome job. And it may be that I'm not making things clear. Here's what I hear happening on the financial. I hear you nailing the guys so they understand, boy, I'm paying too much and not getting very much for it. Is that the, if all you do is that, guys, are our brains designed to do better with comparisons, or to get one object or one thought and try to determine whether that one thought is good or bad? Is it easier for our brains to compare two things, or to look at one thing and wonder, that one thing, is it good or bad? Which one is better? Comparison. I mean, that's how we were. I mean, since we grew up, it was, what's the opposite of good? It's bad. When we get our glasses, which one is better? When we buy our cars, we put them into a table and see which one is better. We compare. That's how we do best. So if all I do is have them realize they're paying too much and not getting very much for it, is there any motive there, guys? Is there any motive? No. It's like, oh, yeah, I guess I am paying too much and not getting very much. But what's the first thing that's going on in my head? But what's better? So they have to realize not just that they're paying too much and getting less for it, but that they weren't shown the very thing where they could have gotten more and paid less. Now, how angry am I? If I know I'm paying too much and not getting very much for it, I'm kind of perturbed. But when I find out the guy purposely didn't show me the thing where I would have gotten a lot more than I'm getting now, and I would be actually paying less for it, how angry would I be? See, if I go buy a Cadillac, and I buy the Cadillac because I want luxury and I want a performance, and I end up paying $70,000 for it. And they say, geez, you paid a lot for that. I'm thinking, well, I guess so. I guess I did. Am I angry or am I just kind of disappointed? Angry or disappointed? At that point. Just disappointed. And one of my buddies says, oh, why didn't the guy show you? Actually, they have last year's model at that dealership. And actually, that model has better leather, has a lot more performance, and you would have paid $15,000 less. Now what am I? I go from disappointed to being angry. Because I know the reason that guy didn't show me that was what? Why didn't he show that to me? Why didn't he say, hey, we got this year's model and last year's model. Here, you decide which one's better. He did not show me that. Why? Because he wanted what? To make more. I start to get perturbed at that point, right? Yeah. So remember, it's not just you're not getting very much for what you're paying for. It's that not only you're not getting very much that you're paying too much for, you weren't shown the thing where you could have paid less and gotten way more than you're getting right now. Do you get that? So Jeff, can you try to explain that maybe in a different phraseology than what I'm doing? Because I find guys are doing the first half, but not the second half.
Yeah. The way I think of it is a joke has two parts. It has the setup and the punchline. If you just do the setup, nobody's going to laugh. There's no punchline. If you just do the punchline, nobody's going to get it. There's no context. So you have to do both. Too much of the time, you guys are doing the setup. You're saying, hey, look, this is bad. But you're not doing the punchline, which is he did that on purpose. And so no one thinks it's funny. No one gets it. So you got to do both. You got to be thinking, I have to do both parts here.
Yeah, that's perfect. That's a great explanation. Not that it's just bad, but that it's bad, but you weren't shown the thing that would have been way better for you, and you would have paid less for that thing. That gets people angry. And I wanted to go back. So I actually went back. This is kind of a funny article I saw. Rolex watch lost 20 years ago, recovered in the woods, recovered, and guess what? Still works. Why does a Rolex still work after 20 hours or 20 years in the dirt? Why does it keep working after 20 years in the quality? So I actually just went back to 2012 which is what, 6 years ago, and just grabbed a tape there just to show you that this, I mean, the 5Q system has worked since 1997. So I thought I wouldn't take I just went back and grabbed something out of the blue here. So I thought I would show you an older tape just to show you this thing has been working for years and years and years. So the tenure is we're going to talk about the pilot experience. Now, do we bring up anything about their current investments, or do we talk about the pilot experience first? Yes, yes, yes. Why do we talk about the pilot experience first? Remember, we always go to first party or third party first? Third party, something that has nothing to do with their current investments, so that we can talk in a reasonable manner. Does that make sense? So we want them to think, yeah, this is how life works. This is how life works. And if life works this way, then I guess my investments will work this way too. But if you go to the investments first, guess what you may get 50% of the time? If you talk about the investments first and try to make a point about the investments before you they may try to wiggle out, right? They may try to give you excuses or make – I've heard people say the most silly things when you go after the money or talk about their money first, because they get defensive, right, Kevin? They get defensive, or Fred, they get resistant. So they'll come up with unreasonable things just because they don't want to look silly. But if they say this is the way the life works, guess how much easier it is get them to understand that, oh, if life works this way, it works the same way as my investment. It's way easier. Makes sense? So we should always start out with the pilot experience first. Then we talk about, hey, how long has people been investing or managing money? So how many types of money, how many money managers are out there? So, and how many of them do you think have, if an industry's been out there 100 years, how many years experience do you think some people have? 5 years or 50 years? So if an industry has been out there for 100 years, how long do you think there's people out there with 30, 40 years experience if the industry's been around for 100 years? Yeah. Yeah, so that's what we want them to come up with. Then they have to say that. So we're going to go ahead and listen to this guy and see how he does here, okay? So here we go.
Yeah, the bonus won't come out.
Oh, before I just want to show you, this is the end of the previous script, and let's listen to what she says when we listen to the end of the previous script, and you tell me if he got what he needed from her.
Yeah, the bonus won't come out of your pocket. I like that part.
Okay, but he's being enticed by the bonus to choose those.
Yeah, there's an enticement besides performance.
Mm-hmm.
And so we see that over and over again. It's one of those areas.
So did she say what he wanted him to say? What'd she say, guys? The guy sold it because there was what? An enticement. So did he get what did he say? Did she say what he wanted to say? What he wanted her to say? Sure, she did.
That's kind of a disappointment. But we see that over and over again. So turnover ratio, 96 is high.
Mm-hmm.
Looks like it's costing about $17,000 a year, which, like you said, going into a more conservative retirement blend, could mm-hmm. show up a lot more than it has. Mm-hmm. You know, it's hard to.
So he got her to say a good thing, and then what do you do? Good things or bad things? Bad things, right, Charles? Why? He got her what he wanted to say, and then guess what he said? Oh, that answer you gave me wasn't good enough. So let me explain to you why your answer is right. No, no, no. If she gives me a good answer, guess what I want to follow that up with? If somebody gives me a good answer, yeah, gots them, absolutely. And then what? Ask another question and like, why? And why do you think that? So yeah, so that's what you want to do. But what he did is he did her good answer, and then he went on to yappity yap 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 yap, which did what to that great answer? Made it better or it undermined it? Yeah, nullified it, exactly. That's right, Nick. So here we go.
You basically show up two times a year and go, oh, good growth. You don't really know what it is. You just go, oh, good.
Exactly.
And they like it that way. Right?
Yeah.
Okay, so who's slamming the broker now? He is. We never want to say a bad word about their advisor. I can call my wife ugly. You call her ugly, we got a problem. they have to say their advisor's bad. And again, he does many good things here, but then what did he do with those good things? he undermines them by yapping. Quit talking.
Okay.
Now they can tell by the lack of questions or the type of questions you ask. So,
right.
But then you just kind of hope there are, you know, moral, trustworthy people, because what else are you going to do if you're not educated? I mean, how long did it take you to get educated in all this?
Yeah. So now guess what she's doing? Because he attacked her guy, she's what? Making excuses, right? So now she's trying to justify, she's making excuses. So he had her right where he needed her. If he were to got her for being so brilliant, for determining that, boy, you got it. You know what? Most people don't realize that. You know what? You moved to the front of the class. Most people don't realize that the reason they do this is to entice them, just like you said. I mean, many people are just, oh, you know, he's a great guy. Da, 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 da. You figured out what? That he did this. Why again? Well, like to entice him. To entice him. To entice him. So, boy, you know, good for you. I need to have you talk to some of my buddies. They don't even get in the industry. They don't even get that. So you nailed it there. So what have I done to that point then about the reason they did this was the reason they sold this stuff was because the funds enticed them to sell it, even though it wasn't good for her. What have I done to that? By gossiping her and telling her how smart she was about that one thing, she now owns that what? She now owns the fact that they did this to entice them. And she feels bad about that or good about that? She feels bad that they did that, but what does she feel about herself? Good. She feels good about herself. But did you hear what she's saying here? What does she sound about her? How does she sound about herself here? So I'm going to play it back a little bit.
Ask. So,
right.
But then you just kind of hope there are, you know, moral, trustworthy people. Because what else are you going to do if you're not educated? I mean, how long did it take you to get educated in all this?
Yeah, she feels like she was apologizing for being stupid. She's apologizing for being stupid there. Do we want a client to ever apologize for being stupid? Or to say it was my fault? I went in there and I guess I am being stupid here, but you know, I thought they were doing the right thing, but boy, I'm not very bright. I guess I thought I would trust them, but no, I don't want them to feel stupid. I want them to be angry at their guy, not feeling like they were stupid for being taken advantage of. Guys, it's the same end, right? They were taken advantage of. They were taken advantage of, and people can do two things when they find out they've been taken advantage of. What are the two things that people can do when they find out they've been taken advantage of? They can blame who? They can blame who? There's two people they can blame. They can either blame what? Themselves or the other guy. And who do we want them to blame? Themselves or their guy? Their guy. And she's blaming who right here? Who is she blaming? Herself, right? So if he would have got her when she said that, would we have had this problem right now? No, she would have felt good about herself and bad about the guy. Make sense? Here we go.
Until you have another option, right? I mean, I never look at somebody cross-eyed for having done the best they can or trusted somebody, as much as I teach on why you shouldn't trust anybody. But until you have another option or more information, you do the best you can,
right?
The next thing I'm going to take a look at comes from this report, and it's called manager tenure, which you're probably familiar with that term, sort of how long they've been there.
Mm-hmm.
And so the average manager tenure on the funds that he's got you in right now is 7 years. So mutual funds have been around since the 30s, so we've got maybe, 82 to 85.
What did he skip here, guys? What did he skip? The pilot story. He went right into what? Her funds. It doesn't always blow up on you, but it's dangerous. It can blow up on you. And how many times do I want something to blow up on me? Never. I never want something to blow. It doesn't mean just because he skipped it, it's going to blow up on him. But it can, and I don't want it ever to blow up on me. So I always start with the third party. And do we just do it with tenure, or do we do it with every single script we have? We talk about things that have nothing to do with their money before we talk about their money. We do that. We try to do that with every single script. So he skipped this, and we'll see if it burns him this time or not. It doesn't always burn you, but Jeff, will it burn you occasionally if you start out with just talking about the money before you set it up?
Yeah, it can burn you, and it will occasionally.
So here we go.
82 to 85 years or something like that. Mutual funds have been around since the 30s, so we've got maybe, you know, 82. Sort of how long they've been there.
Mm-hmm.
And so the average manager tenure on the funds that he's got you in right now is 7 years. So mutual funds have been around since the 30s.
So he's already on step what? What step is he in? What did you say there? We'll go back and step four, right, Charles? He's on step four. He's already, he said your manager tenure is 7 years. So he skipped the first three. That's very, very dangerous. And guys, is there a specific order? Those of you that have, the light bulb was clicked on with the scripts, is there a specific order in the scripts? Are we building, is step one building a platform for step two, is building a platform for step three, is building an order for step four? I mean, so, and when you skip that, guess what? Your foundation has not been laid, and it can cause really, really big problems with the conclusions they come to at the end of the script. Back it up a bit.
How long they've been there.
Mm-hmm.
And so the average manager tenure on the funds that he's got you in right now is 7 years. So mutual funds have been around since the 30s. So we've got.
Who should have said that it was 7 years? Her. But wait a minute. How would she know that, guys? You're right. Those of you saying her, absolutely. But how would she know that? That's right. You show them on the Morningstar report. You point right to the tenure. See where it says tenure? How many years does it say your average fund manager has? Let them read it. That seems like a small thing, but is it a small thing, Jeff?
Oops, sorry, my mute button. No, that's not a small thing. They have to own it. They have to be invested in it. They have to say it.
Yeah, when they say it, it's true. When you say it, they can argue in their own head. They may not argue out loud, but they will argue in their head. See, people will not say something they won't believe. If she didn't believe that that number was right, she'd say something like, well, Morningstar's saying it's 7. What does that say? That she believes or doesn't believe it. She says, well, Morningstar's saying it's 7. If she said that, is she believing or not believing it? No, she means she doesn't believe it. If she says it's 7, then she believes. She says Morningstar. See, if she attributes that to somebody else, in this fact, Morningstar, then I'd have a suspicion she doesn't believe me. So I would follow up. She said, well, Morningstar says 7. Well, guess what? I would follow up. Yeah, Morningstar says 7. And so does that mean it is 7 or it's not 7? I'm gonna see. Are you telling me that you don't believe Morningstar? Is that what you're saying by saying Morningstar says 7? Because if she just believed the number, she would say what? If she believed it was 7, what would she say when I ask her? Yeah, she'd just say 7, Nick. She'd just say 7. But she says, well, Morningstar says 7. She's saying, I'm not going to say it's 7. I'll go ahead and I'll give it to you that Morningstar says 7. I'm not going to say it's 7, though. I mean, that's what I believe is going on in her head. So if I ask her that question, I can see, does she believe me or does she not believe me? Am I talking Greek there, guys? Or does that make sense? Can I get some yays there or nays? Okay. Everybody's saying yes. Good. So now we go.
Maybe, you know, 82 to 85 years or something like that of experience. I mean, there's people that manage mutual funds that are long gone.
Okay, who's doing all the yapping here? Here's the thing, guys. There's only one person people believe 100% of the time, and who's that? Themselves. So any point I need to make has to be made by who? It has to be made by them. Because anything I say is not going to be believed. I don't care if it is believed or not believed. Guess what I think? It's not going to be believed. And if that way I close everybody, not just the people who believe me. And guys, you want to, if you, we've all had experiences. How well do we close people who don't believe us? Well or not well? Not well. So I need to make sure everybody believes me. So guess how I know everybody believes me? Because I never ask them to believe me. I ask them to believe themselves. You ask open-ended questions so that they can convince themselves of these things, not me convincing them. The 21-point checklist scripts work at a 50-50. It works at 50% when you tell them the things. It works at 100% when they tell you the things. And we have lots of guys, Jeff, do we have guys with lots of success that actually do too much telling, selling, preaching, and teaching? In fact, this guy right here has fabulous success, and he does too much telling, selling, and preaching, and teaching. But do people close 100% of the cases when they're telling, selling, preaching, and teaching, Jeff?
No, they don't.
No, and what cases do they miss? The 50 grand cases?
No, the big cases.
Guys, you'll miss those $2 million cases, those $3 million cases if you're telling, selling, preaching, and teaching. You miss zero cases when they tell you. Here we go.
From old age. And the average experience out of experience. I mean, there's people that manage mutual funds that are long gone just from old age. And the average experience level right now in the 23 funds is 7 years. So that takes us back to, was that 2000 and, where are we at here? We're in the 2004, I guess.
As he covered a lot of information so far, a ton of numbers. Yes. Do we have any clue whether she's following at this point or not? Or agrees? Or understands? Or even knows what the heck she's talking about? So I'm going to back it up here. Again, it's a shorter tape, so I can do this. So I'm going to back it up about 30 seconds.
Term, sort of how long they've been there. Mm-hmm. And so the average manager tenure on the funds that he's got you in right now is 7 years.
One number.
So mutual funds have been around since the 30s. So we've got maybe 82 to 85 years or something that of experience. I mean, there's people that manage mutual funds that are long gone just from old age. And the average experience level right now in the 23 funds is 7 years.
Six numbers.
So that takes us back to...
So six numbers in 40 seconds. Guys, how well do older folks do with numbers? I'm pretty darn good at math. Guess how good I'm at math now as compared to what I was 20 years ago? Not as good. So when I'm throwing seven numbers at them in 40 seconds, guess what? She's lost. And that's a danger. Any point worth making must be made by them. Does it take longer? Yes. But am I okay if it takes longer if I'm going to have 100% success ratio versus going faster and getting a 50% closing ratio? I want the 100. I'm at the 100, 100, 100.
The 2000 and, where are we at here? We're in the 2004, I guess. No, 2005. Mm-hmm. And so.
What did she say at this point? Mm-hmm. Because he threw in another three numbers there. Now he's at 10 numbers for about 50 seconds. 10 numbers, a number every 5 seconds. And what she says is, uh-huh. If you didn't hear that, she goes, uh-huh. At this point, do I have any clear picture whether she agrees, doesn't agree, or even understands what I'm talking about? No.
Years. So that takes us back to, was that 2000 and, where are we at here? We're in the 2004, I guess.
God, if he's confused, guess what? He's confused about where they are. If he's confused, you know she's going to be confused. Now, listen to what she says when he asks her this question again.
No, 2005. Mm-hmm. And so...
Mm-hmm.
Let's just pretend you're going to be flying in the New York City area. Do you remember Captain Sully that landed the mm-hmm. So if you're flying.
So again, guys, now he's going back to what? The pilot. There's a purpose we cover the pilot first. There's a purpose. If you do things out of order, guess what happens? If you're putting together an IKEA table and you start in the middle, how well is that going to work? You're putting it in an IKEA, you know, a table from IKEA. How well is that going to work if you start in the middle? Not so good, right, Tom? Not so good. Start. You got to start at step one. It's all building on itself.
And you have a pilot. Do we want like a really experienced one, or would you like the newbie?
Yeah.
And why? You know, it's not like a goose always flies in the engine, or that you have to land on the Hudson. But,
no,
but if it happens, yeah. What do we want, really?
An experience.
I want experience.
So he did a half-assed job there. I want to say, so why do we want to, do we want a pilot who's only flown in daylight hours in good weather? Or do we want a pilot that's also flown in stormy weather? or stormy weather. Do we want a pilot who's only flown during the daytime or a pilot who's flown at night as well? Well, we want a pilot who flows at night as well. And do we want a pilot who has only flown when he can see the runway, or do we want a pilot who can land even in the murkiest of fog? Do we want a pilot who has never had an engine failure, or a pilot who's actually lived through the engine failure? Yeah, so in 30 years of experience, guess how much experience that pilot has? How many things has he seen? Has he seen good flying conditions, bad flying conditions? All of those things, or has he only seen the good? See, I'm going through, because that's going to be a perfect analogy then for the managers when I get there. Then I'm going to go through the history of the manager. So now over 100 years, of course, we want a pilot with great experience. So over 100 years, the market's been around. Actually, more further than that. But the modern market's been around about 100 years. So in 100 years, do you think people only work for 5 years in the industry, or do you think some people have made it a career? Well, I'm sure people have made a career. Yeah, so when we look at manager tenure, do you think if the industry's been around for 100 years, what do you think some of the – do you think there's people only with 5 years experience, or do you think there's people out there with 30, 40 years experience? Well, if it's been around there for 100 years, I'd say 30 or 40 years. 30 or 40 years experience. And so, and we said with a pilot, we wanted somebody with 30, 40 years experience or somebody with 5 years experience. No, 30, 40. Yeah, and it's kind of, do you think that makes sense for a money manager? For example, in a money manager, in 30, 40 years, guess how many times the market's crashed in 30 or 40 years? Once or several times? Well, several times. Yeah, in the last 5 years, how many times has it crashed? Well, it hasn't. Exactly. In the last 30, 40 years, how many times has interest rates gone up or down? Dozens and dozens of times or once? No, I think dozens and dozens in over 30, 40 years. Yeah, dozens and dozens of times. And guess how many times interest rates have gone down in the last 5 years? Well, I don't think they've gone down at all. In fact, they're inching up. Yeah, inching up. So see, I'm going to keep going. I'm going to go through examples. So by doing that, what are they saying? Yeah, my guy with 5 years is what? The guy who's only flown the plane when? During good times. And that's and they've told me if that's a good thing or a bad thing. So am I telling them it's a bad thing, or are they telling me it's a bad thing? And can they tell me anything but it's bad? Make sense?
Somebody that's
why you want to do that. And they say, now, so we said, now when we look here at Morningstar, and why do we like Morningstar again? Well, because it's third party. Because we already covered that earlier. But am I going to ignore that, or get her to say it again that I believe Morningstar? Well, I ignored it. If I've covered it before, am I going to cover it? I'm going to at least say now and again, why do we like Morningstar? I'm not going to go into the whole spiel, but will I at least get her affirmation that she still believes in Morningstar? Just one of, yeah, don't we, because third party. Yeah, you got it, because it's third party. And right here it says manager tenure. So what does it say your average manager, out of your 23 funds, what does it say your average manager tenure is? Well, it says 7 years. Yeah, it says 7 years. So is that somebody who has seen only the, you know, all sorts of things the market could do, all different presidents, wars, markets up, markets down, interest rates up, down, housing crash. Have they seen everything, or have they only seen the last seven great years? Have they only seen the last seven great years? Huh. And what kind of manager we want? The one who's only seen, what kind of pilot we want? Only during flying during the daylight, during good weather, or somebody who's seen everything? So what kind of manager do we want? Think a manager's only seen the good times, or a manager who's seen everything? We've seen everything. Yeah. And why? Why would we want a manager who's seen everything? Because then they're going to be prepared for it. Aha. Are they prepared for the good? Yeah. Are they prepared for the bad? Yeah. I mean, nobody's completely prepared, but at least are they going to panic? No. So what kind of manager do we want? A lot of tenure or no tenure? A lot of tenure. So now what we've done is both sides of the joke, as Jeff has said, both the setup and the punchline, or have we only got halfway there by that? Just halfway there, right.
Brain tumor. Stood up at church literally and said, my doctors gave me like a month to live.
Now, what have I said about telling personal stories? Don't. And guess what he wants? Instead of sticking to the script, guess what he wants to do? Jump into a personal story. And I want you to, this is a great lesson on why you don't want to do this. So here we go.
An experience.
I want somebody I had a friend had a brain tumor. Stood up at church literally and said, my doctors gave me like a month to live. We're all just like,
so what could she be thinking about when he brings up his friend with a brain tumor? Oh, yeah, my mom died of that. Yeah, brain tumors are horrible. I wonder if I have one. I hope I don't, because I'm not remembering things. But dudes, The reason I choose the examples I use is so people don't go off into la-la land worrying about what's happening here.
I mean, I knew this guy and didn't know what he was going to say. Instantly, I just felt like I want to be involved. So I helped start raising money for an operation and all this. And ended up,
So what's he think he's doing here? Showing that he's a what? Hey, I'm going to use this as an example that I'm a good guy. Do they really give a crap at this point? What are we trying to do at this meeting? Does it have anything to do with you? Does this meeting have a single thing to do with you? Are we trying to sell them that I'm a good guy? Am I trying to sell them that I care? Am I trying to sell them on anything about me? No. It's all about who? Their relationship with their current guy. And when you start salting in other things, guess what happens to your conversation about them and their current guy? They lose, it gets confuzzled. Exactly, it gets confuzzled. So here we go.
Choice of two doctors. One was in Atlanta and had done like 1,200 of these surgeries, and another one was in Irvine and had done 60. So we're like, well, you know, it costs a flight. But who do you think we picked?
Yeah.
I want somebody that's bored of it. You're like, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
So
far in this tenure, has she said anything but, Has there been any succinct, complete thought out of her mouth during the tenure so far? No, there hasn't been. But he thinks she's doing what? Great, because she keeps agreeing with him. Because we've been taught, get them saying yes. And if she's saying yes, she's saying yes. But what do we know anything about what her yeses mean? We don't know anything about what her yeses mean.
Average tenure of 7 years, does that sound like a lot of experience or a little experience?
To me, it did sound like a lot, but I don't know.
So, there, did he get what he needed? So, see, if she said up front that pilots, the way that I did it, would anybody out there say anything but, I don't want a pilot with 7 years experience? See, I don't like asking questions I don't know the answer to. So I set it up so there's only one way they can answer. Do you think the way I set that pilot up, would anybody say anything but, no, I want the pilot with 30, 40 years experience? They wouldn't. So they'd say that. Now he's got what? Follow the script, guys, and it will go perfectly. Now he's got another 4 minutes of going back and forth trying to get her to say what he wants her to say. And he finally gets her to say it, but geez, she says it grudgingly instead of with excitement. Do we want them to say it with excitement or grudgingly at the end? That their guy purposely, and he actually didn't show them what he should have. But I just want to show you a couple things. He does talk about a recent Wall Street, this is in 2007, but it says a Wall Street article did research from Standard & Poor's found that funds that consistently outperform others in their peer group typically have a long tenured manager at the helm. In a separate study, S&P found that manager tenure was one of the key factors in distinguishing funds that beat both their peers and the index. In fact, longer manager tenure was more strongly linked to higher performance than lower expenses or widely diversified holdings. So how important does that say tenure is, guys? Important or not important? Very important. Now, I understand it's that's 9 years, 10 years, 11 years, whatever, 11 years old. Do you think things have changed? Or is it still the same? So there is a source here if you want to get that article, okay? But the one thing I do want to make, remember, there's two sides. Stick with me the last 3 minutes. This is important. There's two sides to this coin, again. He's going to get her to say that, yeah, I guess I don't have as much tenure as I should have. Guess what but does that have anything to do with the second part? No. You got to say, now, if you think about it, we do want managers we want a manager with long tenure or short tenure. We want one with long tenure. And yours has what? Well, very short tenure. Yeah, even 7 years, they'll say a very short. They'll say 7 years is very short. So a very short tenure. So how do you think, and we said, do you think that earlier, we said what? That you think there's managers out there with 30, 40 years experience or that they don't exist? Well, can I ask you guys a question? You ever heard of the name Warren Buffett? How long has he been? How many years' experience does he have? Yeah, he actually started investing, believe it or not, when he was 12 years old. He already had, I think, a bank account. By age 16, he already had, oh, at 11. He started at age 11, and by 16, he already had $43,000 he'd made. Now, how much does it cost? How much does it cost to invest in Warren Buffett? How much is... So Warren Buffett is widely regarded as the most invested... I'm not telling you to invest in Warren Buffett, but I'm saying I'm going to bring this to their attention, because think about this. It doesn't cost $100,000 to invest in Warren Buffett. Guys, what does it cost to invest in Warren Buffett in Berkshire Hathaway? What does it cost? Well, basically nothing, because guess what? If I buy a share of Warren Buffett, what's it going to cost? Well, $5 or $7. So I can buy, can I buy $500,000 of Berkshire Hathaway stock for $5? Remember, though, the cost of the stock is not the cost of the stock, guys. That's what? That's the investment. That's, you own the company. The cost of the stock is the company. Is that costing you money? Is that the cost of the stock, how much it's costing you? No. That's what? That's your investment. You say it costs you $100,000 to invest in a $100,000 FIA? No. So do you get it? The cost of the stock is what? The actual investment. It's what they charge you to buy the stock that's the cost. And what are they charging you to buy the stock? $5, $6. So how do you think, if we can buy somebody with 60 years experience for $5, why do you think money managers want to show you, or advisors want to show you, manager or 10 years, didn't show you that, but did show you the one with 7 years experience? Why do you think they did that? So they get paid what? What would an advisor get paid if they sold Berkshire Hathaway for $5? They recommended that their client bought Berkshire Hathaway from TD Ameritrade or E-Trade. How much would they make? Nothing. So why did they show all these managers with 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years of tenure? So they could get what? Get paid more. Now I'm not gonna show them the whole Warren Buffett thing. I'm just gonna go through. So how? And I'm just proving it to you that these. You know what? Because if you showed them this, you'd be screwed, right? If you want AUM, would you be screwed? If you showed them this comparison, you get me in front of your client. You get me in front of your client, then you got AUM with. Guess how long you're gonna have that client with AUM? Not long. Because when they can see they can invest with the best investor in the world for $5 versus you charging them tens of thousands a year, guess who they're going to choose? Yeah. So you don't show them the Warren Buffett. I'm doing that to prove to you. What you're going to do is simply say, we've said that there's managers with 30 or 40 experience or no manager with 30 or 40 experience. No, there's manager with 30 or 40 experience. And yours have how much? Well, 7 or 10. Huh. Were you ever shown that you could have bought managers with 30 or 40 years experience and actually paid less than $1,000 for them? And right now you're paying how much, did we find out earlier? Well, I'm paying like $15,000. Yeah, if you're paying $15,000 and your managers have what kind of tenure? 7 years, yeah. Were you ever shown that you could have had managers with 30 or 40 years experience? And do you think you could be a manager for 30 or 40 years if you weren't good? No, you better be good or they would have fired you. Yeah. So they've been good for 30, and we like them. Why again? Well, because they've seen everything. Yeah. So they've seen everything and they're good or bad. They're good. And you could get them for less than $1,000. Were you ever shown that? No. So why would they only show you things that you, with 7 years experience that you're paying $15,000 for versus managers with 30 or 40 years experience that you could pay less than $1,000 for? Why would that happen? Guys, at that point, guess what just happened to their advisor? He's what? Toast, right? Does that make sense? So it's not just that their managers don't have very much tenure. It's that comparison. Do you get why that comparison? The comparison kills their guy. And did I say anything or did they say everything? They did. So we've taken this little thing of tenure and turned it into a screwdriver lever or a crowbar lever. crowbar. So how good do you want to be at, again, you want to be good at all the scripts. I'm just showing you tenure is not what most people would think is a great thing to leverage. Yeah, it is. Is it or not a good thing to leverage, guys? It's awesome. It's awesome. And every single one of these have that same kind of crowbar leverage. If you do it, as Jeff said, not only the punch, not only the setup, but the punchline, or, and I say that both sides of logic, not just what they have, but what they could have had for at less cost. Make sense? Super. You guys have a great rest of the week, and we'll talk to you all on next Monday. Thanks, everybody.